his teaching and example. They have placed all their hopes in him as the Messiah, the promised deliverer, yet they still didn't understand how he was going to accomplish that deliverance. After the Last Supper, Jesus began speaking about his departure, which led to questions from his disciples. In John 13:33, Jesus said, "My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come." And this prompted Peter to ask where he was going in verse 36. Peter and the others did not understand that Jesus was speaking of his death and ascension to heaven. Jesus' response was, "Where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow later." Peter, still in his lost state, declared that he would follow Jesus anywhere, and even he would lay down his life if necessary. As Jesus patiently continued to teach his disciples, he began speaking more plainly about heaven, describing the place he was going to prepare for them, as we read also in John 14, 2-3. Then Jesus said, "You know the way to the place where I am going." In verse 4, speaking for the others, Thomas, Apostle Thomas, said they did not know where he was going. So they know how to follow him there. If his disciples who were with him could not or could be asking such questions, what about you? What about me? Who only believe without seeing him? You will agree it is very, very difficult. It requires more than faith to believe without seeing. And that faith cannot be developed through hearing. Or that faith can be developed through hearing the words of God and spiritual guidance. And how can you hear the word of God except by obeying what the Lord advised the young rich man to do? One thing you lack, go and sell all you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me.
Amen.
The Lord was asking him to go and do away with his idol, his wealth, which he was worshiping as a god. Like most of you, you may not be as rich as this young man, but are you also not disobeying the second commandments on idolatry? You shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven and above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water or on the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands to those who love me and keep my commandments."
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you love him, you will be ready to sacrifice anything you are doing that is taking your free time on Wednesdays just for 2 hours to enable you here and learn the word of God. We can understand those that have to go to work. But what about the ones who, while away, they are watching television or in complete idleness? You can get rights to go to work. You can get rights to see your doctor. You can get rights to do your shopping. But when it comes to attending church or Bible study, it is always an insurmountable problem. It was in answer to these questions that Jesus uttered one of the 7 famous I am statements. I am the way. Several other times in the gospel, we find Jesus using these words. In Matthew 22:32, Jesus quotes Exodus 3:6, where God uses the same intensive form to say, "I am the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And in John 8:58, Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am."
Amen.
The Jews clearly understood Jesus to be calling himself God, because they took up stones to stone him for committing blasphemy in equating himself with God. But in Matthew 28:20, Jesus gave the Great Commission. He gave it emphasis by saying, I am with you always to the end of the age. When the soldiers came seeking Jesus in the garden, the night before his crucifixion, he told them, I am he. And his words were so powerful that the soldiers fell to the ground. As we read in John 18:4-6, Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, whom seek ye? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus said unto them, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. But as soon as they said, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground. These words reflect the very name of God in Hebrew, Yahweh, which means to be or self-existing one. It is the name of power and authority. Yeah. And Jesus claimed it as his own. If you remember, when God appeared to Moses in the burning bush and sent him to go and meet Pharaoh and deliver the children of Israel from slavery, Moses asked God, suppose the children of Israel ask me, who sent you? What is his name? What should I tell them? As we read in Exodus 3:13-14, then Moses said to God, behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. Now they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said thus, you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am, has sent me to you. You cannot understand how powerful this word is, that we should not use it vainly by equating ourselves with God, because it is such a sacred name of our God. Hence, Jesus being God, use it again, emphasize the uncompromising truth, I am the way. There is no other way. The way. Jesus used this definite statement to distinguish himself as the only way. A way is a path or a route. And the disciples had expressed their confusion about where he was going and how they could follow. As he has told them from the beginning, Jesus was again telling them and us today, follow me. There's no other path to heaven. No other way to the Father. Peter reiterated and confirmed this same truth years later to the rulers in Jerusalem, saying about Jesus, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under the heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Amen.
Amen.
The exclusive nature of the only path to salvation is expressed in the words, I am the way, the truth. Again, Jesus used this definitive statement to emphasize himself as the only truth. As we also saw in Psalm 119:142, says, your law is the truth. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus reminded his listeners on several points of the law, then said, but I say unto you, as we also read in Matthew 5:21-22, you have heard that the ancients were told, you shall not commit murder. And whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court. But I say to you, that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court. And whoever says to his brother, you good for nothing, shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. And whoever says, you fool, shall be guilty enough to go into hellfire. Verse 28, but I say to you, that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. In verse 31, furthermore, it has been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you, that whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a woman who is divorced commits adultery. And verse 33 again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not